is developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral system. First, you have to know what are congenital diseases and what are hereditary diseases. In this, we first discuss about introduction, that is what are congenital diseases and what are hereditary diseases. Congenital diseases means the diseases which are present at birth. And then classification of developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. In that, first is classification of soft tissue and then hard tissues. Then etiological factor in developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. Then classification of hard tissues. First is introduction, that is congenital diseases, the diseases which are present at birth. Hereditary diseases, the diseases which are inherited. Then the etiological factor, which are important in developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. In that, first is genetic factor, in that inherited factor and mutagenic factors. Then environmental factor, then nutritional deficiency factor, some hormones are also causing etiological factor in developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. In environmental factor, physical injuries, that is pressure, trauma, temperature changes and radiation therapy. In hormones, adrenocorticotropic hormone, corticosone, diabetes mellitus, hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism. This is important for you. Hormones in environmental factor, two things are there, physical injuries and hormones. Then nutritional factor, nutritional deficiency, that is deficiency of vitamin A, vitamin B1, B2, B6, niacin deficiency, folic acid deficiency, vitamin B12, vitamin D, E, K, proteins, amino acids and potassium and hypervitaminosis A. Then respiratory problems also are the etiological factor in developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. Then hypoxia. What is hypoxia? Hypoxia is a less oxygen supply to the body. These are also the etiological factor for developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. Then carbon dioxide excess, carbon monoxide, gaseous anesthesia, these are all etiological factor, and some drugs and chemicals also cause the developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. In that, this is important for your MCQ. What are the drugs which affects the oral and paraoral structure? That is salicylates, quinine, tetracycline, thalidomide, pilocarpine, boric acid, nicotine, chloroquine, sulfonamide, selenium and rifampin blue. In that, salicylate, tetracycline is important for you for exam. This is the question which is asked in your MCQ. These are all etiological factor in oral developmental disturbances of oral and paraoral structure. Then we discuss about the classification of hard tissue in the developmental disturbances of the jaw, that is agnathia, micrognathia, macrognathia, facial hemiatrophy, facial hemiatrophy and abnormalities of dental arch relation. That is agnathia. Agnathia means jaw. Agnathia means absence of jaw. What is micrognathia? Micro means small. Gnathia means jaw. That is small jaw. Then macrognathia. Macro means large and gnathia means jaw. Facial hemihypertrophy. Hemi means it affects only one side of face. Then hemihypertrophy means it is the abnormal enlargement of one side of face only. Then facial hemiatrophy. Atrophy means decrease in the size of tissue. The one side of the face or one side of the jaw, it decreases in size. It is called as facial hemiatrophy. And there are abnormalities of dental arch relations. That is, you know, the class 1, class 2 and class 3 relations. The next disturbances is developmental disturbances of lips and palate. In that, congenital lips. You know this double lip and cleft palate. Chilitis glandularis. Chilitis granulomatosa, hereditary intestinal polyposis syndrome, and labial and oral melanotic macule. These are developmental disturbances which affect the lips and the palate. Then we today discuss about the developmental disturbances of oral mucosa, in that foraminous granule and focal epithelial hyperplasia. You know the foraminous granule, this is the developmental disturbances of oral mucosa. It is most commonly seen on the buccal mucosa, it is always bilateral and it is the developmental disturbances of oral mucosa. Then focal epithelial hyperplasia, it is a contagious papillary lesion which is occur on the labial mucosa, lingual mucosa, buccal mucosa, and it is most commonly seen in the children. Then developmental disturbances of gingiva, in that fibromatosis gingiva and retrocuspid papilla. Then next developmental disturbances which is important for your LAQ, it is commonly asked in our departmental exam, that is developmental disturbances of the tongue, in that aglossia. Aglossia, glossia means tongue, aglossia means absence of tongue. Microglossia, that is small tongue. Macroglossia, glossia means abnormally large tongue. Then cleft tongue means the tongue which in the middle of the tongue, there is a cleft present in between the tongue. Then fissure tongue, numerous fissures are seen on the dorsal surface of the tongue. Then median rhomboid glossitis and benign migratory glossitis. Then hairy tongue, lingual varices and lingual thyroid nodule. In the developmental disturbances of the tongue, there are 10 developmental disturbances which is important for your MCQ as well as SAQ and very important topic for your long answer question. Then developmental disturbances of oral lymphoid tissue, in that reactive lymphoid aggregate, then lymphoid hamartoma, angiolymphoid hyperplasia with eosinophil and lymphoepithelial cyst. Then developmental disturbances of salivary gland, in that aplasia, that is xerostomia. Then xerostomia means what? Dry mouth, hyperplasia of palatal gland, atresia and aberrancy, and developmental mandibular salivary gland depression. Then developmental disturbances of heart tissue, in that size of teeth, microdontia. Micro means small, dontia means what? Teeth. Micro means small teeth, macrodontia means abnormally large teeth. Then developmental disturbances in shape of teeth, that is gemination, fusion, concrescence, dilaceration, talus cusp, tension denting, dense evaginatus, invaginatus, tauroodontism, and supernumerary roots. Then developmental disturbances in number of teeth, that is oligodontia, few number of teeth are present. Then anodontia means absence of the teeth, supernumerary teeth, pre-decidual dentition and post-permanent dentition. Then developmental disturbances in structure of teeth, this is also important for your long answer question, in that first amelogenesis imperfecta, dentinogenesis imperfecta, dentine dysplasia and regional odontodysplasia. This is also important for your SAQs and dentine hypocalcification. Then disturbances of growth of teeth, premature eruption, delayed eruption, multiple unerupted teeth, embedded and impacted teeth and ankylosed teeth. Then first, today we discuss about the developmental disturbances of the oral mucosa. What are the developmental disturbances of oral mucosa? First is Fordyce's granule and the focal epithelial hyperplasia. What are Fordyce's granule? In this, the lesion is always bilateral. It is always present on the buccal mucosa. And what is the color of the lesion? It is always asymptomatic and yellow spots are seen bilaterally. First, we discuss about the Fordyce's granule. What is Fordyce's granule? It is also called as ectopic sebaceous gland, or also called as Fordyce's disease or sebaceous nevi. It is not a disease of oral mucosa, but it is a developmental disturbance, and it is mainly characterized by the heterotrophic collection of sebaceous gland at various sites in the oral cavity, but mainly on the buccal mucosa. What is the cause of formation of Fordyce's granule? This occurs due to the inclusion of sebaceous gland in oral cavity, mainly on the buccal mucosa during the development of maxillary and mandibular process of intrauterine life. What are the clinical features in the Fordyce's granule? Firstly, it always present on the buccal mucosa. It is always bilateral. What is the clinical presentation of Fordyce's granule? It appears as a small yellow spot, either seen individually, forming a large plaque, often projecting slightly above the surface of the tissue. it is most, this you know, now most frequently seen in a bilateral symmetrical pattern, and most common site which are affected in the foraces granules are the cheek mucosa opposite to the molar teeth. So these are the clinical pictures of your foraces granule. It is also called as what? Ectopic sebaceous gland. See, this is the buccal mucosa. These are always located on the opposite to the molar teeth. They are always located on the buccal mucosa. And these are, which, what is the color of the foraces granule? These are always yellow in color. What is the main thing in foraces granule? This is the collection of sebaceous gland that occur in various locations in the oral cavity, but mainly on the buccal mucosa. The etiology, it is a developmental variant, that is developmental disturbance. Then what are the clinical features? Multiple small white to yellow or whitish yellow. What is papule? Papule is a raised area of skin, and nodule means it is an abnormal growth of tissue. What are the clinical features of foraces granule? It is a multiple small white to yellow, yellowish white, papular or nodular lesion. What is the size of the lesion? That is 1 to 2 mm in diameter. They are most commonly found in the buccal mucosa. This is important for your MCQ. Foraces granule location, that is buccal mucosa. Most commonly found on the buccal mucosa and vermiculi of the upper lip, and it is most rare on the lower lip. It is commonly bilateral, it is persistent, it is asymptomatic, so no treatment is necessary for this developmental disturbance, and no sex predilection is seen in the foraces granule. Then what are the other sites for your foraces granule? That is inner surfaces of the lip, retromolar trigone, lateral to the anterior facial pillar. Occasionally, what are the other sites which are affected in the foraces granule? Occasionally on the tongue, gingiva, frenum and palate. Current research states that it is also seen in the esophagus, and no significant difference is seen in the between the gender. These are all other sites for your foraces granule. And then histological feature, this is the presence, there is a presence of sebaceous gland, because what is foraces granule? It is a collection of sebaceous gland only. Okay, it is a collection of heterotrophic sebaceous gland. So in histopathology, the presence of sebaceous gland as found in the skin, you know the sebaceous gland morphology. Presence of sebaceous gland as found in the skin in submucosal connective tissue, except the fact that it is not associated with the hair, as like on the as found in the skin. But these glands are located superficially, and it is composed of 1 to 5 lobes and ducts open into the mucosa. See this diagram. This is the your parakeratin plugging. This is the sebaceous gland, which have 1 to 5 lobes. See the lobes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so these are the lobes. This is your epithelium, overlying epithelium, and these are the parakeratin plugging. So these glands are located superficially and are composed of 1 to 5 lobes and ducts open into the mucosa, and duct may show keratin plugging, that is hyperkeratosis is seen on the overlying epithelium. Then main pathologic process, that you know, developmental disturbance of the oral cavity. No treatment is necessary because the lesion or developmental disturbance is asymptomatic. Prognosis, normal variant. Then differential diagnosis for foraces granule is leukoplakia and candidiasis. The next developmental anomaly is focal epithelial hyperplasia. You know the focal word meaning, focal means localized and diffuse means it is a widespread lesion. Focal epithelial hyperplasia. Epithelial means it is a purely epithelial in origin. Hyperplasia means increase in the number of cells, and hypertrophy means increase in the size of the cell. Focal epithelial hyperplasia, it is also called as Hex disease. This is important for your MCQ. What is focal epithelial hyperplasia? It is also called as Hex disease. It is a contagious oral papillary lesion. It is caused by human papilloma virus. This is also important for your MCQ as well as Viva. The focal epithelial hyperplasia is a contagious oral papillary lesion, and it is caused by what? HPV virus, that is human papilloma virus. What are the clinical features in focal epithelial hyperplasia? It primarily occurs in children but may appear in young and middle-aged adults. No gender predilection is there. What are the sites which are affected in focal epithelial hyperplasia? It involves the labial, buccal, lingual mucosa, but mainly gingiva and soft palate can be affected. What is the clinical presentation of focal epithelial hyperplasia? It is characterized by broad-based, slightly elevated, and well-demarcated plaques, frequently papillary in nature, and they have relatively smooth surface and flat top lesion. And the what is the characteristic presentation which is seen in the Hick's disease, that is appears as a cobblestone and fissured appearance. This is important for your MCQ as well as VIVA. In which lesion the cobblestone or fissured appearance is there? The answer is focal epithelial hyperplasia. Then what are the histopathology of the Hick's disease? See, focal epithelial hyperplasia means there is a hyperplasia, means long native pegs are there, then purely epithelial origin, so it affects epithelium only. Focal means it is a localized lesion. What are the histopathology of the focal epithelial hyperplasia? Considerable focal acanthosis of the oral epithelium is seen. What is acanthosis? Acanthosis means what? Increase in the thickness of stratum spinosum layer, right? Then these are the clinical features of your Hick's disease or focal epithelial hyperplasia. It mainly affects the children and young adults. See the on the labial mucosa and buccal mucosa, there is an elevated lesion, right? So this resembles like a cobblestone appearance. So this is important for your MCQ. Cobblestone or fissured appearance is seen in which lesion? The answer is Hick's disease. Then etiology unknown, but it may be caused by human papilloma virus. Then what are the clinical features for your Hick's disease? Age, it most commonly affects 13 to 18 years. They are always multiple, small. What is pedunculated? The lesion which have a stalk, that is called as a pedunculated lesion. What is sessile lesion? Sessile lesion means the lesion which do not have a stalk or a stem. Multiple small pedunculated polypoid or nodular soft tissue growths on the oral cavity. Most common site is buccal and the labial mucosa. Size of it is 1 to 5 mm. White or pink in color. What is the color of the lesion? White or whitish or pinkish in color. So these are all clinical features. Main thing in focal epithelial hyperplasia, there is a cobblestone appearance, multiple small, and the lesion most commonly occur on the buccal and the labial mucosa. Then next is histopathological feature. Then in that, first is hyperparakeratosis is there, that is abnormal thickening of keratin layer. You know the layers of epithelium, first is basal layer, then spinous layer, then granular layer and the corneum layer. Histopathological feature in that hyperparakeratosis is there, that is abnormal thickening of the keratin. Then acanthosis is there, that is, you know, increased thickness of which layer? Stratum spinosum layer. Then coelocyte. What is coelocyte? See this diagram. These are all coelocyte. Coelocytes mean these are epithelial cells, because the mainly the lesion is affects only epithelium. So coelocyte. Coelocytes are the epithelial cells of upper spinous layer, shows enlarged nucleus. See this nuclei? This is your cell, right? This is your nucleus, enlarged nuclei, and they have a clear cytoplasm. These are called as coelocyte. So in histopathology of focal epithelial hyperplasia, there are coelocytes are present. Epithelial cells of the upper spinous cell show enlarged nuclei and vacuolated clear cytoplasm. Then retipex, that is elongated retipex, are seen. Occasionally, liquefaction degeneration of basal cell layer is seen. Then treatment, no treatment, it may regress its own because it is also a symptomatic lesion. Then next developmental disturbances is gingiva. In that, fibromatosis gingiva and retrocuspid papillae. First is fibromatosis gingiva. It is also called a gingival fibromatosis and elephantiasis gingiva. Fibromatosis gingivitis means what? It is also a benign condition. Diffuse condition means it is a widespread lesion. Focal means it is a localized. It is local. It is present only in particular area. And gingival fibromatosis, it is a diffuse condition. Benign, diffuse, infiltrative proliferation of fibroblasts and natural collagen occurring within the soft tissue of the head and neck in young patients. It is a hereditary condition. It is transmitted by a autosomal dominant trait. It is also a developmental disturbances of the oral cavity, that is gingiva. Developmental disturbances of gingiva, in that first is gingival fibromatosis. See, these are the clinical feature of your gingival fibromatosis. So this is always a widespread lesion. This is a widespread lesion, that is a diffuse lesion. It affects which mucosa? Labial mucosa, lingual mucosa. See the enlargement of the gingiva. the etiology unknown but the hereditary is possible. Then clinical feature, the lesion is always generalized, that is diffuse, but often irregular enlargement of the facial and lingual aspect, that is labial and lingual aspect of attached and marginal gingiva. Age at birth, or it can occur in first and second decade of life. No sex predilection is there. The lesion is painless, slowly progressive, completely covering the teeth. The syndromes associated with gingival fibromatosis are Cowden syndrome, Rutherford syndrome, and Laband syndrome. The main pathologic process is benign proliferation. What is the tissue of origin? The tissue of origin is connective tissue. Then histopathology of your gingival fibromatosis. Gingival fibromatosis, first is elongation of the retinal process is seen. You know the histology of gingiva. In the histology of gingiva, the retipics are long, thin, slender reti ridges. So in histopathology of gingival fibromatosis, extreme elongation of reti process is there. Dense or moderately dense, rather vascular, bland collagenic connective tissue with scattered chronic inflammatory cells are there. Mature spindle-shaped fibroblasts, and few of which are multinucleated, are seen. The spindle-shaped cells are mature, and the see, this is the histopathology. See the reti ridges. These are thin, slender reti ridges. The connective tissue is dense. The collagen fibers are haphazardly arranged. So see the density of the collagen fibers. This is the histopathology of your gingival fibromatosis. Then treatment, gingivectomy or proper oral hygiene. Then retrocuspid papilla. What is retrocuspid papilla? It is a sessile nodule. Nodule means what? It is an abnormal growth of tissue. Retrocuspid. Cuspid means it is located on the canine. Cuspid, you know, cuspid lesion. A sessile nodule on the gingival margin on the lingual aspect of the mandibular cuspid. The clinical feature, 2 to 4 mm of sessile nodule of mandibular alveolar mucosa. What is sessile? Means the lesion which do not have a stalk. Nodule means it is an abnormal growth of tissue. It is located on the gingival margin on the lingual to the mandibular cuspid. This site is important for your MCQ. Retrocuspid. See, cuspid means canine lesion. Located on the gingival margin, lingual to the mandibular cuspid. It is more common in children, and this lesion may be unilateral or bilateral lesion. The etiology, this you know. This is the developmental disturbances of what? Gingiva. Then tissue of origin is mucosa. Histological feature, highly vascular fibrous connective tissue, surfaced by ortho or paracuratinized squamous epithelium. Main pathological process is developmental variant. Treatment, no treatment is necessary, and prognosis is normal variant. The next anomaly is developmental disturbances of tongue. This is important for your long answer question as well as MCQ and short answer question. In that 10 developmental disturbances are there. First is aglossia. Aglossia means what? Absence of tongue. Glossia means tongue. Microglossia. Micro means small tongue. Macroglossia means large tongue. Ankyloglossia means tongue tie. Tongue tie means lingual frenum is attached to your floor of the mouth, and this causes what? Speech problems. Okay. The cleft tongue, fissured tongue, median rhomboid glossitis, benign migratory glossitis, then hairy tongue, lingual varices, and lingual thyroid nodule. First, we discuss about the aglossia. Aglossia means complete absence of tongue, that is absence of tongue or rudimentary tongue. This is a very rare condition. Aglossia, main thing, it is a complete absence of tongue, and this anomaly is associated with microglossia. Next developmental variant is microglossia. It is a rare congenital anomaly in that presence of small or rudimentary tongue is there. Aglossia with microglossia with extreme glossoptosis. It is a rare anomaly in the developmental disturbances affecting tongue. The next anomaly is developmental disturbances of tongue is macroglossia. See this clinical picture of the patient. Macro means abnormally large tongue. Macroglossia is a tongue enlargement, which is relatively uncommon disorder. There is no clear definition of microglossia. It may be defined due to in relation to functional and structural term. This causes what? The protrusion of tongue. See, this is the developmental disturbances of the tongue. In that, this is a macroglossia. See the fissured appearance of the tongue. See the abnormal enlargement of the tongue. This is a radiographic picture of the macroglossia. First, What are the macroglossia leads to variety of consequences? That is tongue protrusion, right? See the tongue protrusion, right? This leads to what? Noisy breathing, then speech defects, speech problem, swallowing difficulty, rolling of saliva, and failure to thrive, and airway obstruction. These are the consequences which are seen in the macroglossia syndrome, that macroglossia developmental disturbance, that is tongue protrusion, noisy breathing, speech problems, swallowing difficulty, rolling of saliva, and airway obstruction. What is the treatment for your macroglossia? That is, treatment option varies from observation, orofacial therapy, and surgery. In adults, the initial treatment should be conservative, but the main treatment is partial glossectomy, that is removal of the half part of the tongue. Then the microglossia. See the clinical feature of microglossia. This is your microglossia. This is a condition where the size of the tongue is abnormally small. The congenital anomaly of extreme microglossia is uncommon. It is a very, very rare condition. The tongue will pose many difficulties related to the speech defect, swallowing defect, also cause hypoplasia of mandible. Why they cause hypoplasia of mandible? Because there is no tongue development, so there is a lack of muscular stimuli, there is a lack of dental arch, transverse dental arch relation, so there is a malocclusion problem. So this tiny tongue will pose many difficulties related to the speech defect, swallowing defect, and also called hypoplasia of mandible. So these are some clinical features of your microglossia. See the malocclusion, see the tongue size. This is abnormally small tongue. Okay. Next lesion is ankyloglossia. Next developmental disturbance, that is, it's also called as short frenulum tongue tie, referred to a restricted lingual frenum deferred due to the consolidation of tissue leading to reduced mobility of the tongue. What is ankyloglossia? It is occurs as a, see, this is your ankyloglossia. See, this is also called as tongue tie. Why? Because the lingual frenum is attached to the bottom of the tongue or the floor of the mouth. Ankyloglossia occur as a result of fusion of the lingual frenum to the floor of the mouth. This is your tongue tie lesion. Partial ankyloglossia or tongue tie is a much more common condition because complete fusion rarely occurs. This leads to what? That is speech problem such as lip sync, periodontal problem, and swallowing problem. Next is clinical feature. See, this is the gross appearance of the ankyloglossia patient. See the bifid appearance in the tip of the tongue. This is the bifid or bilobe lingual apex with corresponding midline cleft. See, this is the cleft. This is the cleft, and this is the bifid appearance of the tongue. This lesion is seen in the ankyloglossia. Then this photograph shows the tongue anatomy as the patient is asked to pull tongue back into the mouth as far as possible. Then what is the treatment plan? That is frenectomy. That is, treatment is surgically severe or cut the connection between the frenum and the floor of the mouth. Next lesion is cleft tongue. What is cleft tongue? The cleft tongue means what? The cleft tongue is a condition where the tongue has a cleft running right across it horizontally. What is cleft tongue? See, this is the cleft tongue. See the cleft. The cleft is present between the midline of your tongue. The cleft is always present between the in the middle part, and it is located on the dorsal surface of the tongue. Cleft tongue is a condition where the tongue has a cleft right across it horizontally. What is complete clefting? It is also called as diglossia. It is extremely rare condition. Partial clefting, it presents as a deep groove in the middle of the tongue and is a common feature in the orofacial digital syndrome. This syndrome we are discussing in the diseases of the skin chapter. Okay. This is the clinical feature of your cleft tongue. See the cleft, which is present in the middle of the tongue. The next anomaly is fissured tongue. Fissured tongue means what? Scrotal tongue, furrowed tongue, lingual plicata, plicated tongue, and cerebriform tongue, and grooved tongue. Fissured tongue. What is fissured tongue? It is a condition frequently that is seen in the groove. See, this is your fissured tongue. See the grooves which are present on the dorsal surface of the tongue, lateral surface of the tongue, and these grooves or fissures, these are always interconnected with each other. This groove depth is 6 mm in diameter. This causes what? There is a debris accumulation and there is a secondary infection. So First, what is Fischer term? It is a condition that is frequently seen, that is characterized by a grooves that vary in depth and are noted along the which portion, dorsal and lateral aspect of the tongue. The depth of the fissure varies, but it has noted up to 6 mm in diameter. The fissures or grooves may be interconnected or they may be separated, tongue dorsum into